Good morning, everyone. Welcome to the class of 2021 graduation for the Health Professions Mentorship Program. It's great seeing you all in this virtual environment, and we wish, of course, that we were live, but circumstances beyond our control preclude that for now. But certainly you've endured greatly and handled many challenges. This pandemic has presented, online learning has presented, and you've endured. And to all of you, congratulations. I want to take the opportunity to thank all the family members that are here, that are represented. I'm sure you have parents here, you have grandparents here, you have siblings, you have very close friends. All of you, congratulations. I congratulate you because we know it takes a village to support students. And I'm sure all of you in many of your roles have been a pillar of support. Recently, I had to deal with some difficulty in my own life where I lost a second mother who was 86 years old. I grew up in a community where friends and their parents became my second parents. And even though I had a very loving, nurturing household, individuals who supported me, who mentored me, always were there in the community. And over time, they became extensions of my family. In the case of my late second mom, she became my second mother. She was the mother to one of my closest friends growing up since about sixth grade. I share that with you to say that I hope you value and appreciate mentorship and camaraderie and being there for each other and supporting each other, because that's what the Pipeline Program is about. We want to create for you a support network that lasts a lifetime. There are individuals that poured into me and supported me throughout my years, and so much so that even when they're not with me today, all the things that I've learned from them and all the support that they've provided is still with me. So I think moving forward, keep that in mind. The Health Professions Mentorship Program here at Sophie Davis is one where we started in 2015. Where we are today is that we've graduated nearly 125 students. 70%, nearly 70% of those students have indicated that they're going forward with a healthcare related profession in college. All of the students that we've graduated have entered college. I've maintained contact with students going back to 2015 when we first enrolled the class. And that young man is looking forward soon to graduating college, as I think of one in particular. He graduated in 2017. He's interested in a physician assistant, and I've written a number of letters of recommendation for him. So I share that with you to say that our support will always be there for you, whether you apply to our program, Sophie Davis, or whether you apply to any other healthcare related or interest that you have going forward. Your mentors, the teaching assistants, the whole Sophie Davis family is here with you. I recently was listening to a religious leader, and he said something that I think captures the journey. And this wise leader said that life is 10% adversity and 90% of what you do about that adversity. 10% adversity and 90% of what you do about that adversity. I think that's something that we all have to continue to reflect on throughout our lives. Recently, I had a conversation with a neighbor, a colleague, and someone who also serves as director of admissions at another college in CUNY. Our discussion was about the important qualities that we think foretell a student's success in the journey going forward to college. And of course, I thought about all of you while we were having this conversation. There are a number of things that we agreed on that I want to share with you that we think are real important as qualities among many. These certainly are not all of them, but we tried to capture the essence of the very key ones. We talked about empathy. And empathy is the core of being a healthcare professional. Empathy, we hope, of course, is something that you continue to mature into. You want to be able to relate and feel and understand someone's struggle and difficulty, and you want to be a good listener in being able to better understand it. Sensitivity is what we also discussed. The ability to step outside of how you think and feel and imagine yourself in someone else's situation, their shoes, their experiences, how you would feel, how you would react. That creates, we think, a great deal of sensitivity. Compassion, an ability to be able to want to help, to convey an understanding as a part of making someone's condition feel better and moving, helping them to move forward. Leadership, being able to start, to be the first, to co-found the club, to make an impact, knowing in your heart and your gut that this is something that's important to do. And sometimes in leadership, as my friend and I discussed, it's lonely because people may not always agree or see it your way. But if you believe firmly and are convicted, leaders sometimes have to stand alone on a mountain because they're working so hard and may not have all the support that they need, but eventually that changes. And leadership means taking on those responsibilities and moving forward. Mentorship, very important. As you know, in the Pipeline program, the mentors that have surrounded you with support, that have surrounded you with love, surrounded you with caring. Advocacy, one of my favorite ones. Advocacy to me, as my friend and I discussed it, and it has broad meaning and implication. Advocacy to me has always meant, in addition to a number of things, someone who supports you and can be a voice for you when you're not in the room to support and be the voice for yourself. An advocate is someone who might write that letter of recommendation for you when you are applying to an institution or for a summer position. But an advocate has to speak for you when you're not in the situation to speak for yourself. And an advocate is someone who supports. And as a healthcare professional, you often have to advocate. When the patient is not in the room with you, you have to stand for their rights and in support of them. We said maturity because we feel that maturity is an ongoing growth process, and that your maturity today is very different than it will be 2 or 3 years from now. So when I hear the word immaturity, I hear potential to mature. In many stages in our lives, we are all maturing. Therefore, don't have the degree of maturity that we need. We can call that immaturity, but I choose to look at it as maturing and growing into challenges, into yourself as an individual. We said that one has to have the ability as a student to reflect on themselves, the ability to understand their strengths, their weaknesses, how to improve them, how to make them better. We also went on to say that it's very important for students to be able to feel comfortable in settings of diversity, where people who they interact with, who are their classmates, who are their friends, who are their neighbors, may have different cultures, may have different ethnic groups that they're a part of, may speak different languages, but the ability to appreciate it, to understand it, is critical. And finally, we said it was important for that student, that individual, to understand the importance of improving the quality of life for others, making a difference, having input to change the dynamic, to make it better for the next person. And I think with all of those qualities being stated, it's important that you continue to work at it, you continue to mature and grow into it, and understand that your work in the pipeline program and going forward is the beginning of the journey. Adversity will be waiting for you, but it's always a matter of how you tackle it. And you will be given the tools, the support, the advocacy to be able to move forward to tackle the adversity. I want to introduce our Dean, Dean Friedman, Dean Erica Friedman, who approached me a number of years ago in about 2015 in working with the pipeline program as we were putting it together, sort of constructing it. And here we are in 2021, you're being the fifth class graduating, and we've matured into a stronger pipeline program with a stronger alumni base. And it was has been under her direction and leadership that so much of this has been possible. So many people work real hard behind the scenes and don't receive a lot of attention, don't receive a lot of accolades. She, in my opinion, is one of those individuals. And I can relate to that because in many respects, I'm also a behind the scenes person. Dean Friedman, welcome.
Thank you, Mr. Irves. Good morning, Pipeline and CUNY School of Medicine students, parents, friends, faculty, and staff. It's a shame that we can't be together in person to celebrate your impressive accomplishments. But this is only one small consequence of the horrific impact of COVID-19 on the lives of all of us, but disproportionately for so many, because of their social determinants. Heartfelt congratulations to all of you for successfully completing this program in the midst of COVID-19 and having to do it virtually since last March. The healthcare professions have made some strides in recent years to promote and achieve a diverse workforce that represents the diversity of our patients and ensures access and equal care for all. Yet, data show there is still much work to be done in meeting this need. Pipeline programs like ours need to be one of the solutions to addressing these issues, to help promote a culturally competent, diverse, and prepared healthcare and biomedical research workforce. Now more than ever, in the face of COVID-19, and the disproportionately negative impact it has had on communities of color, it's even more important that we recruit a diverse healthcare workforce to enhance patient care, ensure health equity, dismantle the structural racism in the healthcare system, and to improve the social determinants that impede health and wellness. As Mr. Irves said, the Sophie Davis Health Professions Mentorship Program at the CUNY School of Medicine enrolled its first class in the summer of 2015, and you are our fifth graduating class. Our vision for this program was to recruit students who expressed an interest in healthcare and expose them to the breadth of opportunities in the health profession where they can make a difference in the quality of people's lives. We also wanted these students to leave understanding the huge role that social determinants play in the health and well-being of communities. We hope that you have a better understanding of the many different options for the various health professions. We hope you have made new friends. We hope we have helped you believe in yourselves and your ability to advocate for and to make a difference in this world. Throughout this two-year experience, you have learned that health equity means that everyone has a fair and just opportunity to be as healthy as possible. This requires removing obstacles to health, such as poverty, discrimination, and their consequences, including powerlessness and lack of access to good jobs with fair pay, quality education and housing, safe environments, and healthcare. Imagine and keep a vision of how we together can transform our policies and infrastructure to create and make a reality a just and equitable future for all. We have an amazing group of faculty, staff, and students who have invested so much in creating and sustaining this program. Many thanks to Mr. Irves for his consistent commitment to the recruitment of students and supervision of our student mentors, and to Dr. Jody Myers for support and oversight of this program. We are also so lucky to have our faculty, Drs. Nunez, Lamb, Hernandez, and Lima, with their enthusiasm and dedication to the program and students. And most importantly, to your 7 student mentors and TAs who understand the importance of paying it forward and being role models for what you are all capable of becoming. I wish you the very best and hope you keep in touch with us and let us know where you've chosen to continue your education and what major you will pursue. We know you will make a difference in this world and are proud you have chosen to spend the past 2 years with us and have become a part of the CUNY School of Medicine, Sophie Davis family.
Thank you, Dean Friedman. Now for your student class speaker, Azan.
Good morning, teachers, faculty, mentors, and my fellow students. My name is Anzan Sachdeva, and I'm currently a senior at Forest Hills High School. I'm honored to be speaking on behalf of my classmates for the conclusion of the 2019-2021 Sophie Davis Health Professions Mentorship Program. I did not exactly know what to expect when I read Community Walks on the Sophie Davis Health Professions Mentorship Program website. The only research I really knew at the time revolved around dissecting animals or slicing up a cell. It involved DNA and proteins, and it involved genetics and mutations. With a notebook in hand and an absurd amount of pens and highlighters, I showed up to my first day of the program, expecting it to be similar to a biology class or something of the sort. To my surprise, on the very first day, we were asked to list out as many health professions as possible. We listed out everything from OBGYNs and pediatricians to cardiothoracic surgeons and neuropsychologists. After we'd exhausted our minds of what we thought was every possible health profession out there, our instructor, our mentors, and our TAs continued to urge us to think a little harder, to think a little farther, and to think a little broader. That, I feel, is when we broke out of the mental box that we were in regards to healthcare. We listed policymakers, hospital managers, epidemiologists, insurance workers, social workers, and more. We then segued into learning about the network of people that make healthcare possible. From writing bills that limit the use of e-cigarettes to maintaining the quality of education to the future doctors in the world, we learned that healthcare is an iceberg with hundreds of miles of ice below the surface. Through this program, I learned so much about the city that I grew up in. How places in New York that are only a couple miles apart vary so much in resources. How the Upper West Side and Central Harlem are less than 3 miles apart, only a 16-minute drive between them. And yet the Upper West Side has 3 bodegas for every supermarket and Central Harlem has 11. How in the Upper West Side, about 17 out of 100,000 people will die before the age of 65 due to heart disease, while in Central Harlem, 58 out of 100,000 will. The deprivation of essential resources like fresh produce, quality education, safety, and healthcare leads to the isolation of minority and poor communities. It leads to cultural, linguistic, financial, and educational isolation, in which a person of color does not receive the same basic resources as their white counterpart. The social determinants of health, the underlying conditions in which people are born, grow, work, play, and live, deeply affect the health outcome of countless of people, not only in New York City, but anywhere else in the world. So in this program, we took a look at healthcare through a sociological lens. With an open mind and a new take on healthcare, we created projects addressing the adverse psychological and physical health outcomes of people of low socioeconomic backgrounds and minority groups face in their everyday lives. In this process, we also grew as students and learned about the hardship of those outside our immediate social networks. A new sense of advocacy was instilled within us, and I'm sure that no matter what the future holds for us, that each and every person in this program, including myself, will strive to be a catalyst for social change and will continue to advocate for the underserved.
Ozan, thank you. We're now going to have a special presentation by our students. It's a part of their community health assessment, and they want to share it with all of us.
Okay. Good morning, everybody. My name is Victor Anusike. I'm a mentor for the Pipeline program. And this presentation is a compilation of all the different projects that our great students completed throughout the 2 years in the program.
Good morning, my name is Lila Ariste. Our first year, we focused on the effects social determinants of health had on one's health outcomes. This included the role that someone's socioeconomic status, education, residence, access and availability of resources, and race played in their overall wellness. After listening to lectures by professors at the CUNY School of Medicine and having discussions with our mentors, we were expected to apply this knowledge to the community. We were divided into three different groups and assigned a community like the Upper West Side, Harlem, and Hamilton Heights. We were to select an issue in our community and explain how the existing resources may help or exacerbate this issue. We were able to find out more about our assigned communities by taking walks through them and using photo voice to document the different things in our community that reflected the reality of its inhabitants. Street intercept surveys allowed us to assess how people felt about the overall health of their community. This project taught us about the challenges in healthcare and possible ways to combat them. It also helped with our presentation skills as we were expected to present our findings to our peers and the school staff.
Thank you. Good morning, all. My name is Tanzi Farhan, and I'll be presenting a brief synopsis of our first year project, Spoil Your Kids, Not Their Health. We were assigned to observe and discuss the social and economic determinants of health. Our group focused on Hamilton Heights and its rising problem of childhood obesity. The prevalent trend of delis and bodegas and the absence of parks discouraged children from participating and engaging in a balanced lifestyle. We used street intercept surveys to find out how New York City residents felt about this issue of childhood obesity in order to collect data. The findings of the street intercept surveys revealed that New York City citizens agree that as time goes by, childhood obesity is worsening. However, the data collection process was not without restrictions, meaning Hamilton Heights was the target group, but the people interviewed were only asked to decide whether or not they live in New York City. Additionally, relative to a standard sample size, the sample size taken was very small, as only 42 individuals were interviewed. Moreover, we were not able to ask individuals under the age of 18 these questions explicitly and could only ask adults. Thus, the data is not as reliable as it would be if a wider group of individuals were interviewed. In order to come to a conclusion, there are different steps that a community should take in order to tackle the issue in order to address the climbing obesity rates of children. My group and I planned an advocacy initiative, which entails holding an annual family field day where we increase awareness about safe living, which includes consuming balanced meals, physical exercise, and preventive medicine. Physical activities would be present for children to become more involved and connected with others. This not only supports their emotional and social health, but also creates excitement for children in order to get out and play and communicate with others. We also thought it would be better to include both parents and guardians as well, because they're basically the first teachers of their children. It is important to have a strong relationship with health and exercise within a family.
Hi, I'm Samaya.
And I'm Nicole, and we're presenting a project that we worked on our first summer called Don't Sugarcoat It, We Are Diabetic.
Our group chose to research the factors that have an impact on the high rates of diabetes in Central Harlem. We chose this topic because we noticed the scarcity and high cost for fresh foods, as well as the lack of fitness centers and gyms in Harlem. Additionally, its status as a low-income neighborhood and a food desert further contributes to the city's rising rates of type 2 diabetes. During street intercept surveys, locals were asked to participate in a four-question survey. The participants thought that to better their community, there should be more healthy food accessible to the public, less junk food and fast food restaurants, and more places to exercise. the unavailability of effective and efficient resources to promote healthy living in this neighborhood is a major concern for the community leaders. We also use Photo Voice, a visual research methodology, to document the abundance of bodegas and fast food restaurants, as well as the lack of grocery stores, places to exercise, and fresh food markets. Our group also noted the prices of these items, which showed that the healthier food options were generally more expensive, and items such as cigarettes and sugary drinks were inexpensive. And these are some of the pictures that we took during our community walks.
And here are the results from our intercept survey. We found that 2 in 3 people frequently saw liquor stores in the neighborhood. 17 people regularly noticed smoking ads in the neighborhood. 10 people did not feel that there were enough open spaces to engage in physical activity. And 4 in 5 people felt that childhood obesity is not getting better. In order to counteract the high rate of diabetes in Central Harlem, more supermarkets and farmers markets should be added. The relatively low prices of unhealthy foods in stores and restaurants should be increased, while more affordable, healthier options should be made available. Grants should also be made available to open green groceries and supermarkets, as well as zoning laws should be implemented to minimize the amount of fast food chains and change their placement. To continue, neighborhood sidewalks and parks need to be resurfaced and repaired. Advertisements about diabetes and community awareness, as well as information centers, should be implemented around Central Harlem, and they should replace the ads that promote fast food restaurants. Informational sessions about diabetes, their risks, and overall community health should be added to middle school and high school curriculum.
Hi, my name is Valentin Uri, and we'll be presenting New York City Adults Are Binging, Not Shows, Alcohol. During the first year, my group and I focused on binge drinking as a health issue in the Upper West Side and developed possible solutions to reduce this problem. Binge drinking is a consumption of 5 or more drinks in males and 4 or more drinks in females. It's been proven to lead to serious health issues and possibly death in some cases. According to statistics, we found that about 27% of individuals engage in binge drinking behavior, which demonstrated the prevalence of our research. A major cause of binge drinking stems from the environment, which is where we focused much of what we were studying. The Upper West Side is a very affluent neighborhood with many resources and facilities open to the public. However, the Upper West Side has more than 20 bars and liquor stores, providing greater means for residents to access alcohol. Statistics from the Department of Health and Mental Hygiene demonstrated the quality of the physical, economic, social, and service environment. Some things we found is that there is an average income of $127,000 a year. 4 to 5 residents have a college degree, and 95% of residents have medical care. Through the use of Photo Voice, we were able to observe the community and the condition of the public services. We noticed how the sidewalks were clean, how there was access to the council member's office, and gardens for residents to be active in their community. However, with this, there were numerous amounts of stores selling alcohol at low prices and many advertisements marketing the consumption of alcohol. We determined that the Upper West Side provides great availability for people to abuse the consumption of alcohol and engage in binge drinking behavior.
Okay. The Street Intercept surveys asked Harlem residents for their thoughts on the health of their neighborhood. The consensus among people interviewed was that there weren't enough places for physical activity. There is an abundance of advertisements about drinking and smoking, and childhood obesity is getting worse. When asked what could be done to fix this problem, many people said there should be more ways to get healthy food and safer environments to exercise. While this survey was not conducted in the Upper West Side, we found that drinking is a problem that most of New York City faces. We came up with 8 different intervention plans, including a BuzzFeed-style quiz that determines a person's vulnerability to binge drinking. This quiz would ask 10 questions about drinking habits, and based on the score at the end, your vulnerability to binge drinking would be determined. A score from 1 to 5 means that a person has no drinking habits, and a score from 27 to 33 means a person engages in extreme binge drinking. From our findings of the Upper West Side, we decided that educating people about the harmful effects of binge drinking could help them reduce their consumption of alcoholic beverages.
Thank you. In the second year of the program, the groups focus on individual presentations based on anatomical, physiological, and psychological diagnoses in the human body. Alongside the individual research done by the students, they also attend numerous lectures given by doctors, professors, researchers, and their mentors and TAs. For the main objective of the second year of the program, students were able to receive extensive knowledge on how adversity in childhood can lead to criminal behavior, the psychological effects of quarantine on adolescents during COVID-19, and the difference between congenital and acquired neuropathy from their research. These are a few of the projects conducted.
Hi, my name is Mariana Capuchin, and I will be introducing the second year projects worked on by myself and my colleagues, Tanzim Farhan, Laila Ariste, Anzan Sachbeda, and Christy Han. So my group decided to do research on how adversity in childhood can lead to crime. In doing our research, we looked for various determinants of crime and searched for articles related to the correlation between family background and criminality. We were able to compile our findings and form our thesis, which was that if children face childhood adversity, then the rate of delinquency and crime would rise. So moving on, we found that relational trauma in children arises from attachment difficulties. This is on the next slide. This often happens when the child's guardians are not able to be emotionally available for their kids, which often leaves the kids feeling anxious, impulsive, and can lead to increased stress, among many other factors. We actually found that 93,000 kids that were incarcerated in 2016, 93% of them were victims of childhood trauma or some sort of trauma. Continuing with our research, we began to find out what is actually happening in the brain for this trauma to occur. We found that two main parts of the brain that respond to emotions and control behavior are the amygdala and the prefrontal cortex. It was found that trauma can compromise these normal development of these two parts of the brain in adolescence and may affect criminals in the future. We even found a 1994 study in which murderers who pled not guilty by reasons of insanity showed deficits in the prefrontal cortex. So overall, our main findings were that family background and relational trauma in children affect criminality in adulthood. We found that child maltreatment and crime have a positive correlation. And so my last parting thoughts lay in the idea of what can be done with our findings. Perhaps we can work to find treatments for criminals that addresses their mental health and prevents them from committing these crimes again. Just one example of this that we were able to find was restorative justice, in which the criminal would be connected to its victim in hopes that they may repair the harm done and find ways to heal their crime committed against the victim. Thank you for listening, and I will hand off the mic to the next group.
All right. Hi, everyone. My name is Arya Singh.
And I'm Gaurav Kumar.
And we will present our group research on the psychological effects of the COVID-19 quarantine on adolescents. The coronavirus pandemic has caused millions of people in cities worldwide to retreat to isolation. While the main focus of quarantine is to prevent the control or spread of disease, prolonged isolation has brought limited social interaction and support, which has resulted in the deterioration of mental health in people. Mental health consists of our emotional, psychological, and social well-being. It is a state of mind and affects how we function on a day-to-day basis, how we react to certain situations, and it determines our choices. In order to further research this topic, our group conducted surveys and polls on our social media platforms to collect data. We also examined various articles and case studies to supplement our thesis. We surveyed about 200 adolescents through a Google form, and we received about 2,600 votes on our Instagram polls.
Based on our research and prior knowledge, we hypothesized that countries engaging in prolonged isolation due to the COVID-19 pandemic will result in declining mental health in adolescents.
To form our hypothesis, we analyzed general psychological trends that occurred in teens throughout the 2020 quarantine. For instance, we noticed a sudden spike in hotline calls providing mental health assistance to people as we isolated ourselves. Next slide. Our group decided to utilize Google Forms as our primary source of collecting data. We created a survey with 9 questions revolving around factors that contribute to or affect our mental well-being. The answer choices that we provided would indicate the degree of health and activity among adolescents throughout quarantine. Our group distributed our questionnaire online by posting a link on our social media accounts. We also created a short poll on Instagram in regards to physical activity and procrastination trends upon isolation.
Our primary question on Google Form was, what is your age range? The follow-up questions were, how would you rate your mental health right now? How much sleep have you been getting? And one open-ended question, how have you kept yourself busy during this quarantine? There were also 2 Instagram poll questions. The first question was, compared to before quarantine, how productive have you been recently? And compared to before, how physically active have you been recently? Next slide. Subsequent to using different methods to test our hypothesis, our group collected a variety of data. We accumulated 257 responses on our Google Form survey, in addition to approximately 2,600 votes on each of our Instagram polls. A majority of these respondents were within a 14 to 17 age range. The results from our questions indicate that most respondents engage in unhealthy activities, such as having unhealthy diets, feeling anxious or stressed, losing interest in their hobbies, and feeling lonely. Simultaneously, most respondents have claimed they have received an adequate amount of sleep and are engaging in physical activities like playing basketball, biking, and walking. For instance, out of the 257 responses, most respondents were in relatively stable or positive mental state. 32.7% of people rated their mental health a 4 to 5, and 31.5% rated it 3. Meanwhile, majority of participants also believe their changes in appetite had been for the worse. 40.9% of people now reported somewhat unhealthy diets from being in quarantine, while 24.9% stated their appetites have stayed the same. And from our Instagram polls, we received an influx of responses that indicated a decrease in physical activity over quarantine. As half of the participants voted that they have been less active compared to before isolation. In addition, about half the respondents voted they have experienced moderate procrastination from work in quarantine. Change slide.
All in all, we received mixed outcomes from our data because the responses did not conform to simple trends of good or bad mental health. Many factors contribute to mental health and mental stability, including sleep, appetite, stress, activities, and exercise. With that being said, there are no definitive results that indicate complete psychological deterioration within adolescents in quarantine. For those who have been struggling with their mental health, there are various ways to stay healthy and communicate and change your lifestyle for the better. It is recommended that you consistently communicate with your family, friends, and loved ones. You should also take care of your body by exercising, meditating, eating healthy, and getting plenty of sleep. Thank you.
Hi, my name is A. Jackson.
And my name is Noelle Lama, and we're presenting our second year project.
Last summer, we were asked to further research a disease, disorder, or condition that sparked our interest. The topic our group chose to research was acquired and congenital neuropathy and how they differ from each other. We decided on this topic because we were all interested in learning more about a specific disease known as congenital insensitivity to pain, or CIP, and how it impacts the nervous system. While conducting research for this project, my group and I were able to learn more about what neuropathy is and the different types of neuropathy, specifically acquired neuropathy and congenital neuropathy. We began to research CIP because of its connection to congenital neuropathy, looking into both the epidemiology and pathology of the disorder. We also looked into the epidemiology and pathology of diabetes due to acquired neuropathy being a commonly known symptom of diabetes. This helped us gain a further understanding of how both types of neuropathy develop in those with CIP and diabetes, as well as how the symptoms affect those with these diseases.
Okay, sorry. Although we had to adjust to working remotely, we were able to confidently present our new knowledge and findings to a larger group. While we were not able to see each other and play our usual games of Mafia in person, working remotely felt the same as we joked around and played games like Among Us. Using Zoom, it allowed us to effectively work together, collaborate, and easily share ideas. This new experience taught us crucial life lessons such as managing our time wisely, adapting to foreign situations, and maintaining a work-life balance. This new experience has emphasized the importance of our education and prepared us to take on any challenge that may come in the future. As mentors, helped us learn and students work together during this difficult time, we learned the power of our teamwork. And we also learned with dedication and passion, there is nothing that can stop us from learning. Thank you.
So as the COVID-19 pandemic spread across the globe, the students along with their mentors decided to create a variety of projects, ranging from quizzes about COVID-19 to videos thanking healthcare workers for their undeniable courage. These projects aided the students in understanding the correlation between healthcare and the pandemic, while also allowing us to play our part in stopping the spread of the pandemic by sharing our projects across social media platforms. For the COVID project, I decided to go a little bit out of my comfort zone and do an animation about how COVID infects cells and then the rest of our body.
Okay, let me know if you can't hear it.
How does COVID-19 infect our cells? Well, to start off, COVID-19 generally infects the cells in our lungs. But why only our lungs? Well, because lung cells have an ACE2 receptor acting as a lock to the spikes on the virus that act as a key. So much like we enter our homes with a key, the virus enters our cells. Now, once the virus is in our cells, it releases its RNA into our cells. But wait, first we have to know that this virus is an RNA virus, so its RNA also acts as its DNA. Now, once the virus releases its RNA into our cell, it essentially takes over our cell's functions and makes our cell produce more viruses. And once there are millions of viruses in our cell ends up exploding, releasing all of those viruses into our body. And once there are enough viruses in our body, we begin feeling sick, and that's when symptoms develop.
Yeah, so one thing I just wanted to make clear is that when coronavirus hit the nation and I guess the entire world, we worked together with the students to make short videos like this to spread on social media so that way more people could be aware of what COVID-19 was and what could have been done to stop it. And while that video was shared, the students also created another video to thank the healthcare professionals. And let me just play that right now. Hey, hey, everything gonna be all right. Gonna raise a glass and say, hey, here's to the ones that we got. Cheers to the wish you were here, but you're not. Cause the dreams bring back all the memories of everything we've been through. Toast to the ones here today. Toast to the ones that we lost on the way. Cause the dreams bring back all the memories. And the memories bring back your. There's a time that I remember when I never felt so lost, and I felt all of the hatred was too powerful to stop. Oh, yeah. And my heart feel like an ember. Okay, so that's the end of the presentation. I want you guys to know that, you know, our students worked really hard to do a bunch of different projects. Not every project that there were more projects that our students did, but this is just a sample of everything that we did for the past, I guess, 2 years. So I would usually say give our students a round of applause, but you guys are all muted. So this, I guess, an imaginary round of applause is cool. Okay. So you guys can hear me, right? Okay, I assume you guys. Okay, so right now I'm going to segue to giving my speech as a mentor. So just to remind everyone, my name is Victor Anusike. I'm a Sophie Davis student, but I was also a mentor for this cohort of students. And now I will give my remarks. So, dear students, mentors, TAs, and faculty, my name is Victor and I'm a Sophie Davis student. And I am also a mentor for the Sophie Davis Healthcare Professions Mentorship Program. I want to start today by talking about USB drives. Or rather, a USB drive with the name Sophie Davis on it. This was the reward given to the group of students that were able to successfully complete the campus-wide scavenger hunt that the mentors and I devised during our first summer with the students. And I see some people laughing. The scavenger hunt forced students to trek across the entirety of City College, a campus that they were still getting used to find and solve clues that were based on the medical and clinical knowledge we taught them. during a day when the weather was particularly hot and humid. Suffice to say, the students who finished the hunt after a 3-hour-long period, especially when you consider it was only supposed to be 1 hour, were looking for something, anything, to justify their completion. So when the winning group, drenched in sweat, saw that the reward they received for their journey was a USB drive, you can imagine the look on their faces. This is not to say that the winning group wasn't grateful. On the contrary, they looked pleased that the group was able to complete the hunt. But the group that won, as well as the other groups that saw the prize, laughed. I remember one student, visibly tired after walking from the towers all the way to the Grove building back and forth, asked me what I thought the students were meant to gain from such a long activity. And half jokingly, I mentioned that the point of all this wasn't about the destination, but the journey, about the friends they made along the way, and the growth they would receive as a result of embarking on this journey. I can't for the life of me remember whether that comment caused the students to laugh or roll their eyes or do both at the same time. But after working with these students for 2 years, after seeing them grow in their knowledge of medical expertise and the social determinants of health, as well as their maturity to wield these tools of knowledge for the greater good, I think that my previous statement holds more weight now than I would even realize when I first stated it almost 2 years ago. Today, we celebrate the graduation of the class of 2021, the destination that these students have reached after a long result of working through 2 summers and multiple months of school, in person and online, deserves to be praised. And yet, I think it's important to realize that the completion of this program isn't really a destination, or at least as far as the students are concerned, this isn't really their final destination. It's rather a very important step in their lifelong journey to become professionals who wish to make the world a better place. And I am absolutely confident that they will succeed in this journey. During the past 2 years, I've seen how intelligent these students are firsthand. During the first summer, the mentors and TAs taught these students about the social determinants of health, a concept that, while internally understood by people, isn't the first thing aspiring medical professionals tend to think of when they think of medicine. I remember how this new concept seemed to many of them, and how wide-eyed they appeared when they explored New York City neighborhoods, eager to apply many of the concepts they learned into tangible action for the first time. This memory is vivid to me because it provides a sharp contrast to their significantly improved understanding of these concepts today. But when I think of this particular cohort of students, what comes to mind most immediately is adaptability. To the teachers, faculties, TAs, and mentors, I have to say this to you guys. High school may seem like a long time to many of you guys, but we shouldn't forget how challenging that critical part of our educational career is. While we mentors and TAs were giving these students challenging assignments and fields of study they were just being exposed to, they also had to deal with their regular classes, studying for exams, and applying for colleges. Quite a few of my students were juggling jobs and familial obligations. Eventually, as the pandemic hit, these students, who were ripped from classrooms and thrust into chat rooms, who needed to adjust to the mental and cultural impact of living through historical times again and again and again, were called upon to do more. And each time, they showed up and shined, because to them, their education wasn't just a privilege, it was a priority. I had no doubt before that no matter what these students ended up doing, they would bring progress to the world and happiness to the people they cared about. But after being with them through unprecedented times, I also have no doubt that no changing situation or troubling circumstance will derail them in life. They learned about pandemics during a pandemic. Who's to say they don't have enough experience to one day stop a pandemic? What I remember the most is that I routinely considered how my actions and behaviors would influence them, not for fear of reprimand from higher ups, but due to a deep desire within me to help them reach the potential that I knew they had. I've told my fellow mentors, friends, and family members that I've learned much more from them than they think they've learned from me, in a capacity that they will probably never really understand. Today is their graduation from the program, but I encourage you students to consider this ceremony, this point of time, as not an end point. This ceremony is an inflection point to look at how much you've matured since the first time we met. It's just one more necessary step on your path towards your careers as you continue to grow into the great professionals and even greater people that I know one day you will become. Thank you.
Thank you, Victor. And of course, as you all appreciate, it's been a family of special mentors working with the students. And I want to take the opportunity to introduce Italy Beaton.
Hey, everybody. I hope you guys are doing well this lovely morning. I just want to say I'm so, so proud of my students. I've seen the growth in all of them from when they were doing those street intercept surveys and they were so shy to come up to strangers and ask them the questionnaires, to now being able to give speeches in front of all these students and all the other parents and faculty. I am so, so proud of you all. From getting amazing news from summer and the college applications and getting all the all their acceptances, like I'm just extremely proud of this group of students because I've seen the growth. I've seen how hard they've worked on each of these projects and how hard they've worked on their college applications, on their college essays. And I have them all hitting me up at different times of the day to ask for help. And I'm always there for them. And they know that. So I'm just so proud of them and so proud of the shell that they have broken out of and are now comfortable in speaking publicly, especially Nawang and Zay, who were one of my two major introverts, have now stepped up to give a speech in front of you all. And I'm so proud of them. And I'm just happy and elated and I'm happy to see where they're gonna be in the next few years in the future.
Thank you, Adley. Daniela Pinzon, also a mentor, has some words.
Hi, everyone. My name is Daniela Pinzon. So I was a mentor for an amazing group of students. I had Mariana, Tanzim, Christy, Lila, and Mariana. And I just want to resonate with everyone else. Like Victor mentioned something really important, and it's like high school is such a huge step in our academic success, and they're all so, so smart. It really surprises me. I'm just like, wow, these kids are so smart. And they've done a great job this whole year. It has been awesome to see them grow for 2 years now. It's bittersweet to let them go now and go in to do like really great things. And I'm just proud and just happy to be part of your lives. And hopefully the really great thing I think about Pipeline is we've established a relationship that not only ends here, but continues on to the future. And I'm just really excited to see where my students go. And I'm really proud of all of you guys. So thank you.
Thank you, Danielle. Next is Joanne Voyard.
Okay. Hi, everybody. My name is Joanne. I'm an M2 student. I was also one of the mentors for this year. I just wanted to say how honored I was to be a mentor to these group of students, especially my group of students, Sihi, Gurav, Samiha, Aria, and Raya. I'm so proud of the young women and men that you have grown to be. Yeah, I came in late, but I feel like I've known you guys for a very long time. And every time we're talking, it's you guys are always teaching me something new. And I hope that I've imparted some knowledge onto you guys as well. And like everybody has said, I really hope that we remain in contact. I would love to hear from you guys after high school, in college, and I already know you guys are going to be the best physicians if you choose not to go into the medical field, whatever fields that you guys are going to be in, I know you guys are going to do great because you guys have just exhibited so many great things during this entire experience. And it was truly an honor to be your guys' mentor. So thank you guys.
And I understand that we will also have some words from Hector Reyes.
Thank you for saying my name with such gusto, Mr. I appreciate that. There is a concept that perhaps many of you will be familiar with. And for those who are not, I shall explain it. And those who are, you already know where I'm gonna go with this. So there's something known as the will of fire. I'm gonna pause for a second to scan the faces, see if anybody, okay, I see a smile. Perhaps this is registering with some of you. So this wheel of fire is something that originates with one generation, and just as a torch, it's carried on to the next and to the next and so on and so forth. I have definitely been inspired by those above me and by those below me. And so the wheel of fire is not something that is linear in its progression. It's something that stems out and touches and lights other flames, other torches. And in that way, it's kind of ubiquitous. It goes everywhere. As the previous mentors have kind of touched upon it, we have tried to light that fire within all of y'all. And to my own delight, it has been a reciprocal process. We have tried to inspire you, but in the end, I feel I have definitely been inspired by y'all. Bright students, always willing to go the extra mile. The list is endless of the wonderful qualities that y'all all possess. And it was truly a pleasure knowing all of y'all. And so I ask that once you reach our stage, that you try and continue keeping that fire safe. And not only that, but passing it on to the next generation as well. Because y'all's fire is bright, shine so brightly, and it definitely needs to be illuminated and observed by the world. So thank you all for being such a wonderful class to work with.
Thank you. Thank you all mentors. And want to take the opportunity in the spirit of will and fire and passing it along and support to also thank the teaching assistants. Tracy Valadon, I saw, is here. Michael Holmes as well. So many people contributed to your success and poured so much into you. This is probably the challenging part for me, and that is to make certain I don't forget anyone. So I'm going to be very deliberate, and I hope you bear with me. I also want to thank many of the mentors who are in the first year class who are here showing support. I think it's interesting to note that the first year set of mentors, many of them themselves are graduates of the Health Professions Mentorship Program, and they were a part of the original class in 2017. And for those of them who are here, a shout out and thank you for being here. Also want to thank the first year students who I'm sure are very moved by this, very impressed by this in a way that it motivates and inspires them. Want to also thank the many faculty that are involved with making this pipeline program a success. Dean Freeman has indicated it, but I just want to emphasize special thanks to Dr. Hernandez, Dr. Lima, Dr. Nunez, Dr. Lamb, and Dr. Meyer for all of their ongoing support. We cannot all do this alone. It has to be a village. I also want to thank two people that are very special that helped me tremendously with administering the pipeline program. They often make me look good. And that is Jason Morenci and Chelsea Napier, who are behind the scenes assisting as they always have been, as they consistently have been over the years. And I want to thank them for their commitment, their hard work, their ingenuity. They have a tremendous caseload as they are also Sophie Davis students. But they give their time through a committed effort. And Jason and Chelsea, thank you. It's greatly appreciated. And now for the students, congratulations. And I'm going to call your name in acknowledgement. I trust everyone is here. And even if you're not here, I definitely want to acknowledge you. We normally have certificates that we give to students if we are doing this live. In absence of that, I want to call your name, and please be patient with me as I deliberately go through the pronunciations of your names. I want to get it as right as possible, and I want to take some time to do it accurately. But the spotlight will be on you, so we'll give a little time for that to happen if you're here. Congratulations to all of you, starting with Jessica Abu. Congratulations, Jessica. Congratulations to Saru Ahmed. Congratulations. Samia Alam. Congratulations, Samia. Layla Arist. Congratulations. Nicole Yusaran. Mariana Capistran. Congratulations. Jennifer Cheetah. Congratulations. Sahit Taku. Congratulations, Sahit. Tanzim Farhan. Congratulations. Rhea Francisco. Congratulations. Christy Han. Congratulations, Christy. Valentine Ure. Congratulations. Zay Jackson. Congratulations, Zay. Gaurav Kumar. Congratulations. Nuang Lama. Congratulations. Kinsiola Obamu. Congratulations. Gabriella Poliger. Congratulations. Summer Prasor. Congratulations. Sumia Robinson. Congratulations. Luzan Stachdeva. Congratulations. Kelsey Sodina. Congratulations. Usanula Shirazad. Congratulations. Aria Singh. Congratulations, Aria. Aminu Sterling. Congratulations, Aminu. Theodore Siamondis. Congratulations. And certainly, not least but last, Stephanie Toussaint. Congratulations to all of you. Please stay in touch with us. The relationships that you formed with your mentors, your teaching assistants, and the Sophie Davis family is guaranteed for a lifetime. If we can do anything to be of support in your journey going forward, know that your family is here for you. And again, congratulations and congratulations to all of your families. Thank you for coming out to the Class of 2021 Health Professions Mentorship Program graduation ceremony. I wish you all well and do stay in touch with us. Hi, everyone. We're going to unmute you. So if you want to have some shout out fun to each other, you certainly can.
It's such a hard way to end something that's so such a special program. I do want to give a special shout out to the TAs and mentors. I know what you put into it. Obviously, as Hector talked about, you get so much out of it. And I think you also teach the pipeline students what they can do in terms of paying it forward. But I also want to really give, really for the pipeline students, it was such a pleasure to see the work that you did. And to, I thought your posters were fabulous. I'm sorry that we can't all be together in Harris Hall this morning. You know, we've all gotten used to this is the way that we do things now. I guess at least we can see each other and kind of have a feeling of being together. And as everyone has said, we really hope that you'll stay in touch with us and let us know about your journey going forward. And a special thanks to Mr. Irves for all that you do for this, making this program such a very special part of the CUNY School of Medicine. It's really terrific.
Thank you.
Hope you can all have a great day. And even our Sophie Davis CSOM students, take a little break from your studying and just soak it up.
Thank you, Dr. Meyer.
Hi, all right, so it's working for me.
Hi.
Okay, I just wanted to take a second and thank everyone for this great opportunity. We've definitely made a lot of fun, enjoyable memories with each other. Like Victor mentioned before, the scavenger hunt, all the community walks, playing Uno and Mafia and whatever it is we did in our lunch periods. So I'll definitely miss that. And I just really like to convey my gratitude for what a great learning experience it's been, because honestly, the pipeline program opened my eyes up to the actual world of like healthcare disparities. And it's just, I've learned a lot and I've made a lot of new friendships with you all. And I'm just really grateful for the pipeline program. And yeah, I'm looking forward to staying in touch with everyone. And I just hope we all just move along together. I know that a lot of my friends at the pipeline program are interested in medicine. So yeah, I'm just looking forward to the future with you all, and I'd like to thank you all again.
Thank you, Ryan.
I also want to thank all the mentors. You guys have been awesome. You guys are like friends to all of us, and I'm going to miss you guys. It's been great.
Yeah, hopping off of Mariana, you guys are like our brothers and sisters. Like outside of this program, you guys helped us so much with our essays or just like anything personal. Especially for me, Joanne, like she helped me a lot with my essays, or even if I just had to hit her up just for just talking. Like me and Joanne had a really good relationship, and even the other mentors as well, Hector, Victor, Haley, Daniela, and Wura, I hope I'm not butchering it, but, and I like the reference, Hector, from Naruto. It's good. I'll definitely carry on that will of fire.
I'd just like to say thank you to the mentors, and I just remember like the first day, like I could barely like talk, I couldn't even say my name. But now because of all the work we've done, and I no longer like, I mean, I still feel fear, but I feel like it's allowed me to open up and actually voice what I'm thinking and have confidence that I have ideas that are worth sharing. And also I love the friends that I made all along the way. I feel like each one of you inspired me in a different way. Because you guys are all really smart, and it's nice to see what you guys come up with, and also the mentors as well for encouraging us. Thank you.
I just wanted to say that I remember the first day when I was kind of nervous, and I was only like sticking with the friends like I already knew. And then like when we had, I think it was like the lunchtime, and we go in like the area with like the eight ball and stuff, and we were finally like communicating with other people, and I met a lot of friends there. And I know that a lot of us want to go either into medicine or like another route, but we still have each other's numbers and like social media, so we'll always like contact if anything. And I wanted to thank the mentors, because like what everyone said, you guys are like our brothers and sisters, and like we can talk to you either educationally or like personally, which I really like. And yeah, I just wanted to say thanks for like opening up my social circle and like giving us laughs, especially Victor. He always made me laugh whenever he was talking. So thank you.
So if there is no one else, and I want to allow time in case there is, again, congratulations to all of you. Stay and remain in touch. And we wish you all Godspeed. Thank you.